Nuclear fusion is a polarizing subject, and false media statements do not exactly help painting an unbiased picture. This video aims at providing a fact-based and easily digestible understanding of the progress in nuclear fusion. Grab a cup of coffee and let's talk about it. In this video, we'll debunk common myths, learn why the achievements in the recent years brought us a significant step closer to nuclear fusion becoming a viable energy source on Earth. If you'd like to learn more about technology's economic viability and climate impact, please subscribe below. And let's dive into how close we are to engineering an economic breakeven in fusion power. An increasing number of private companies is aiming to deliver commercial fusion and producing significant breakthroughs in the science and technology that will lead to a commercial power plant. There are now at least 35 fusion companies and progress is accelerating. 15 were founded since 2010, and 18 have declared private funding of almost $1.8 billion to date, plus an additional $85 million in grants and other funding from governments, taking the total to $1.87 billion. Four companies, Commonwealth Fusion Systems, General Fusion, TAE Technologies, and Tokamak Energy, currently account for 85% of the funding. There is still enormous scope for investment and innovation in this emerging industry. 71% of companies believe a 2030 target for grid connection is achievable for fusion, while 20% believe that it won't be ready until the 2040s or 50s. Companies are taking a variety of technical approaches to solving the challenges of fusion power. So, what are the most common misconceptions? You might have heard about Q, the fusion energy gain factor. But did you know that Q total is lower than Q plasma? This is very important because most of the energy actually never goes into the plasma. Q plasma is simply the comparison of the power being released by the fusion reactions in the reactor to the constant heating power being supplied. Q total actually describes the engineering breakeven. So how big is the difference between Q total and Q plasma? Well, ITER advertises a Q, that's a Q plasma, of 10. The standard input of ITER is about 300 to 400 megawatt. It is designed to produce 500 megawatt. If we assume it would permanently run and the efficiency is about 65%, and I'd say that's pretty optimistic, that would result in a Q total of about 0.68, so below 1, so below breakeven. Misconception number 2, safety. You may have heard of the saying, perception is reality. Well, in nuclear power, perception is actually significantly off reality. There is still often confusion about the differences between nuclear fusion and nuclear fission, resulting in people being overly skeptical about the safety and sustainability of nuclear fusion. And even nuclear fission is irrationally perceived as more dangerous than the facts prove it actually is in reality. Based on mortality rates, nuclear fission is by far the safest way to produce energy. More than 350 times more deaths come from coal and more than 260 times more deaths from oil compared to nuclear fission. It's almost like the fear of flying. People should actually be way more worried to drive a car than hop on a plane. Well, admittedly, the pictures of plane crashes look a little bit more spectacular than those of car accidents. And mortality rates are of course based on existing power plants. Today, the nuclear industry is working on the Generation 4 reactors, and they will have a combination of active and passive nuclear safety systems that would be at least as effective as those of the Generation 3 systems and render the most severe accidents physically impossible. And nuclear fusion is inherently safe. Since fusion and fission are both nuclear power sources, people assume similarities. However, nuclear fusion is fundamentally different. It does not involve a chain reaction, and if something goes wrong, the fusion reaction would simply stop and the reactor would cool down. Misconception number 3, waste. When it comes to nuclear waste, nuclear fusion also does not compare with fission. But before explaining why nuclear fusion does not create any long-lived nuclear waste, I'd like to point out that nuclear fission reactors are also evolving, and so is the reduction of their waste. Generation 2 reactors are the vast majority of existing nuclear fission plants out there. Generation 3 reactors is the state of the art, and Generation 4 reactors are expected to enter commercial operation in 2030. Generation 4 reactors promise not to leave any long-lived fission products, meaning materials with a half-life of more than 200,000 years. If common misconceptions were to influence decision-makers, amazing potential would be at risk to remain untapped. Fusion is among the most environmentally friendly sources of energy. There are no CO2 or other harmful atmospheric emissions from the fusion process, which means that fusion does not contribute to greenhouse gas emissions or global warming. Its two sources of fuel, hydrogen and lithium, are widely available in many parts of the Earth. So how close are we really to engineering breakeven? And how close are we to economic breakeven? When will nuclear fusion provide energy to the grid? Before we jump into these very exciting fusion breakthroughs, I'd appreciate if you could help out this channel simply by hitting the like button. If you haven't done so, please subscribe and hit the notification bell. So I'd like to point out three outstanding breakthroughs: the progress in high-temperature superconducting magnets, NIF's 1.3 megajoule record in laser fusion, and the development of low-temperature power electronics technology. Achievement number one, the high-temperature superconducting magnet. For the first time, a large high-temperature superconducting electromagnet was amplified to a field strength of 20 Tesla, the most powerful magnetic field of its kind created on Earth. That successful demonstration helps resolve the greatest uncertainty in the quest to build the world's first fusion power plant that can produce more power than it consumes, according to the project leaders at MIT and startup company Commonwealth Fusion Systems. That advance paves the way, they say, for the long-sought creation of practical, inexpensive, carbon-free power plants that could make a major contribution to limiting the effects of global climate change. A major innovation in the MIT CFS fusion design is the high-temperature superconductors, which enable a much stronger magnetic field in a smaller space. This design was made possible by a new kind of superconducting material that became commercially available a few years ago. SPARC, designed to be about half the size of ARC, is a testbed to prove the concept before construction of the full-size power-producing plant. Until now, the only way to achieve the massively powerful magnetic fields needed to create a magnetic bottle capable of containing plasma heated up to hundreds of millions degrees was to make them larger and larger. But the new high-temperature superconductor material made in the form of a flat ribbon-like tape makes it possible to achieve a higher magnetic field in a smaller device, equaling the performance that would be achieved in an apparatus 40 times larger in volume using conventional low-temperature superconducting magnets. That leap in power versus size is the key element in ARC's revolutionary design.
I'm looking forward to the point, sooner rather than later, that there will be fusion power plants on the grid and will be in a decarbonized electric system. And I believe at that time, we'll look back and think about when it was that we realized that this was going to become a reality. When I really believed that this would work was with the demonstration of the magnets. And that time is now.
The Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory's National Ignition Facility, NIF, made a significant step towards ignition, achieving a yield of more than 1.3 megajoules. This advancement puts researchers at the threshold of fusion ignition, a really important goal, and opens access to a new experiments regime. From an engineering point of view, inertial effusion is still a long way from energy breakeven. Achievement number 3. Low-temperature power electronics. Tokamak Energy recently announced the breakthrough design of cryogenic or very low-temperature power electronics technology for the high-efficiency operation of its superconducting magnets. This will result in reduced cost of future fusion power plants, which is key to commercialization and scaling the technology. The power electronics team at Tokamak Energy has developed a novel power converter inside a vacuum cryostat. Successful tests have demonstrated a 50% reduction in the power required for cooling HTS magnets. The superconducting magnets are used in tokamak fusion reactors to contain and isolate plasma so that it can reach the high temperatures at which fusion occurs. One of the main challenges for the magnets is the cryogenic cooling system, which is one of the biggest power consumption loads on a tokamak. Improving cooling efficiency will reduce costs for future fusion power plants. So what's next? To learn more about 9 promising next steps in fusion power, stay tuned and check out the next video.